I don't know if eventually the traditional bank or the legacy banks will disappear. Definitely the neobanks will continue to earn and to increase their market share.
Welcome back to this videocast, where my guest today is the regional director of Central Europe for Viva Wallet, a neobank that has recently raised $80 million, Dimitris Papaioannou. Hello, Dimitris.
Hello, Pierre. Thank you for having me, Pierre.
It's my pleasure to have you. And in this third chapter, we will talk about the future of the banking market. And my first question to you is, will traditional banks actually disappear and will be replaced with neobanks? What do you think?
I don't know if eventually the traditional bank or the legacy banks will disappear. Definitely the neobanks will continue to earn and to increase their market share. And I'm pretty sure that after a few years, it will be completely reversed from the market share that they are having, that we are having now. So I believe that we will have the bigger market share compared with the traditional bank. Just because the traditional bank, the legacy bank, let's say the systemic bank, they are not able, or they don't want, or it's not very easy for them to adopt by embracing all new technologies that exist out there.
In the second chapter of this videocast, we talked about microloans that we are already providing in some countries. Do you think that eventually some services of the banking sector will be reserved to traditional banking, or do you think neobanks will eventually offer all the services that are currently available on the market?
I'm not sure that it's very, very easy. First of all, it depends from the business plan and the vision of each neobank. From our side, as Viva Wallet, we don't have the intention to propose or to provide or to create 55 or 50, I don't remember exactly how many different banking products that the systemic bank are having. We want to continue what we are doing by giving the opportunity to our merchants, to B2B merchants, to take micro loans via their acquiring transactions that they are already having. So to make this much easier from the way that they are doing now. No, we don't have the intention to start giving loans for buying a house, for going on vacation, for other type of products that today exist. But this doesn't mean that there will be another neobank, that they will focus on this specific product only. I believe that it's pretty difficult for a systemic bank to become a neobank, obviously. For a systemic bank to switch all of these products fully digital for their consumer or for the merchant. Maybe they will do it for some of them, specific for the one that they are easier or more, let's say, easy to provide, to present, or to complete the whole flow online. Because one of the difficulties is not just to post in your website that I am giving this product online. It's the implementation behind. And the implementation behind on a legacy bank is combined with legacy systems.
Do you think that some services will never be proposed by neobanks, like loans? I mean, not microloans, but real loans for a mortgage or something like this. Do you think that neobanks will eventually be able to propose them as well?
Yes, I believe that they will be able to propose them, depending from the capital they are handling, depending from the risk appetite that they are having, depending from the way that they would like to introduce themselves to their clients or to the consumers. Yes, for sure.
So you were mentioning that perhaps the market share of neobank will flip, or actually will grow, and that retail banking will actually be in a minority. Isn't there a danger here for neobanks to grow too big and to eventually have all the disadvantages of retail banking today?
As I said earlier, I think that the neobank is the next step of fintech. It's software houses or companies that they started by having a payment institute license or an e-money license, and then they had to upgrade their license or to have a banking license in order to serve their clients better. So, again, it depends from what these neobanks would like to do. For us, we don't have the intention, for us as Viva Wallet, we don't have the intention to become, and I will say it, I will use a terminology, but I think that this is the right terminology. We don't have the intention to become a supermarket bank by providing all type of services. We will provide only specific products, 1, 2, 3 maybe in the future, but always aligned with the acquiring services, the issuing services, and the fact that they will be, we will give the opportunity to our merchant to have easier some specific products.
So we talk a little, very much about merchants. So we understand that Viva Wallet is entered in retail. In the future, do you think that Viva Wallet will expand its activities and propose services or specific services to other sectors, to other industries, and not limit itself to retail?
No. If you are asking me if we have the intention to go into the consumers, no, we don't have the intention to go into the consumers. We will remain strictly on the B2B part, but we will continue to combine and to use innovative solutions in order to approach different type of merchants. Micro SMEs, SMEs, micro enterprises, large enterprises, depending on the maturity of each country and the footprint that we are having in each country, we will be able to approach bigger or smaller merchants, because when you are entering into the market, it's not easy to take a big merchant. You have to be localized. We have localized our product in all of the countries, and this will allow us to be able to onboard from a huge, let's say, music festival that they would like payment solution, smart payment solution, a big retailer that he would like to have touch screens in order to accept payments, up to a taxi driver who would like, by having an Android device, to accept payments because he's having some clients that they are using him for the airport or for journeys or whatever.
Thank you very much, Dimitris. It was very nice talking to you today. And for people watching us on YouTube, or for those listening to us on Apple and on Spotify, so all the links to the different resources that we have touched in this videocast, podcast, will be in the descriptions. Thank you very much, Dimitris.
Thank you very much, Jeff, for the invitation and for the opportunity to present what we have done. Thank you.
Thank you.